Thank you. Light and peace in Jesus Christ our Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Dear people of God, 40 days ago we celebrated the joyful feast of the Nativity of Jesus. Today we recall the day on which he was presented in the temple, fulfilling the law of Moses. Led by the Spirit, Simeon and Anna came to the temple, recognized the child as the Christ, and proclaimed him with joy. United by the same Spirit, we now enter the house of God, where we shall recognize Christ in the breaking of bread. Let us pray. O eternal God, who has created all things, on this day you fulfilled the petitions of the just Simeon. We humbly thank you for the gift of these candles, which have been blessed for your use in the Church of the Holy Sepulchre in Jerusalem. Graciously hear our prayers and be merciful to us, whom you have redeemed by your Son, which is the life of the world, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
Lord, now lettest thou thy servant depart in peace. According to thy word. For mine eyes have seen thy salvation. Prepared before the face of all people to be a light, to lighten the Gentiles, and to be glory of thy people Israel. Glory be to the Father and to the Son and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end.
God, source of all light, today you revealed to the aged Simeon and Anna your light which enlightens the nations. Fill our hearts with the light of faith, that we who bear these candles may walk in the path of goodness through Jesus Christ, the light of the world. Amen.
Mary, Mother, meek and mild.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Almighty and ever-living God, we humbly pray that as your only begotten Son was this day presented in the temple, so we may be presented to you with pure and clean hearts by Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Let the testimonials of election now be read.
This is to certify that at a special council of the Diocese of the Church in the Diocese of Southern Virginia, duly called in accordance with the Constitution and canons of the said diocese, and assembled in Dinwiddie High School in Dinwiddie, Virginia, on September 21st, 2019, the Reverend Susan B. Haynes, being at least 30 years of age, was duly elected by a constitutional majority consistent with the Constitution and canons of the Diocese of Southern Virginia, and that all requirements of the Constitution of the Episcopal Church have been complied with. In witness whereof, we, the Right Reverend James B. Magnus, president of said convention, and the Reverend Ralph E. Haynes, the third secretary thereof, have hereunto set our hands and caused the seal of the diocese to be affixed this third day of October, 2019.
Canonical testimonial of election. Diocese of Southern Virginia, testimonial of election of a bishop diocesan. We, whose names are hereunder written, fully sensible of how important it is that the sacred order and office of a bishop should not be unworthily conferred, and firmly persuaded that it is our duty to hear testimony on this solemn occasion without partiality, do, in the presence of Almighty God, testify that we know of no impediment on account of which the Reverend Susan B. Haynes ought not to be ordained to that holy office. We do, moreover, jointly and severally declare that we believe the Reverend Susan B. Haynes to have been duly and lawfully elected, and to be of such sufficiency in learning, of such soundness in the faith, and of such godly character as to be able to exercise the office of bishop to the honor of God and the edifying of the church, and to be a wholesome example to the flock of Christ. Dated October 3, 2019, signed by Susan A. Grimm, president of the Standing Committee. I hereby certify that the above canonical testimonial was signed by a constitutional majority of the Council of the Diocese of Southern Virginia, meeting in special council at Dinwiddie High School in Dinwiddie, Virginia, on the 21st day of September, 2019, signed Ralph B. Haynes, Secretary of Council.
Certificate of Ordination. This is to certify that according to the Recorder of Ordinations, Susan B. Haynes was ordained to the diaconate on December the 21st, 2004, by Bishop Edward Stuart Little II at St. Thomas Episcopal Church in Plymouth, Indiana, and to the priesthood on June the 24th, 2005, by Bishop Edward Stuart Little II at St. Thomas Episcopal Church in Plymouth, Indiana. The Church Pension Fund, in its capacity as Recorder of Ordinations, signed Felicia Diaz.
Certificate of Consents of Standing Committees. I hereby certify that consents have been received from the standing committees of 57 dioceses to the ordination and consecration of the Reverend Susan B. Haynes to be Bishop Diocesan of the Diocese of Southern Virginia. Susan Grimm, President of the Standing Committee.
Testimonial from the bishops pertaining to the ordination and consecration of the Bishop of Southern Virginia. Be it known by all the people of God that 83 bishops, being a majority of bishops having jurisdiction in this church, have consented to the ordination and consecration of Susan Bunton Haynes as a bishop in the Church of God, and to her status in the House of Bishops as Bishop of Southern Virginia. Being 1,126th bishop in the American succession. Signed, Diane M. Jardine Bruce, Secretary, House of Bishops.
My sister, please make your declaration.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, I, Susan Bunton Haynes, chosen bishop of the church in Southern Virginia, solemnly declare that I do believe the holy scriptures of the Old and New Testaments to be the word of God, and to contain all things necessary to salvation. And I do solemnly engage to conform to the doctrine, discipline, and worship of the Episcopal Church.
My brothers and sisters in Christ Jesus, you have heard testimony given that Susan Haynes has been duly and lawfully elected to be a bishop of the Church of God to serve in the Diocese of Southern Virginia. You have been assured of her suitability and that the Church has approved her for this sacred responsibility. Nevertheless, if any of you know any reason why we should not proceed, let it now be made known. Is it your will that we ordain Susan a bishop?
That is our will.
Will you uphold Susan as bishop?
We will.
The scriptures tell us that our Savior Christ spent the whole night in prayer before he chose and sent forth his 12 apostles. Likewise, the apostles prayed before they appointed Matthias to be one of their number. Let us, therefore, follow their examples and offer our prayers to Almighty God before we ordain Susan for the work to which we trust the Holy Spirit has called her.
God the Father,
have mercy on us.
God the Son,
have mercy on us.
God the Holy Spirit,
have mercy on us.
Holy Trinity, one God,
have mercy on us.
We pray to you, Lord Christ.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the Holy Church of God, that it may be filled with truth and love and be found without fault at the day of your coming, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all members of your church in their vocation and ministry, that they may serve you in a true and godly life, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For Michael, our presiding bishop, and for all bishops, priests, and deacons, that they may be filled with your love, may hunger for truth, and may thirst after righteousness, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For Susan, chosen bishop in your church, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That she may faithfully fulfill the duties of this ministry, build up your church, and glorify your name, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That by the indwelling of the Holy Spirit, she may be sustained and encouraged to persevere to the end, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For her family, that they may be adorned with all Christian virtues, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who fear God and believe in you, Lord Christ, that our divisions may cease and that all may be one as you are and the Father are one, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the mission of the church, that in faithful witness it may preach the gospel to the ends of the earth, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who do not believe and for those who have lost their faith, that they may receive the light of the gospel, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the peace of the world, that a spirit of respect and forbearance may grow among nations and peoples, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those in positions of public trust, that they may serve justice and promote the dignity and freedom of every person, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For a blessing upon all human labor and for the right use of the riches of creation, that the world may be freed from poverty, famine, and disaster, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the poor, the persecuted, the sick, and all who suffer, for refugees, prisoners, and all who are in danger, that they may be relieved and protected. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For ourselves, for the forgiveness of our sins, and for the grace of the Holy Spirit to amend our lives, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who have died in the communion of your church, and those whose faith is known to you alone, that with all the saints they may have rest in that place where there is no pain or grief, but life eternal, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Rejoicing in the fellowship of the ever-blessed Virgin Mary, Joseph, Simeon, Anna, and all the saints, let us commend ourselves and one another and all our life to Christ our God.
To you, O Lord our God.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God of unchangeable power and eternal light, look favorably on your whole church, that wonderful and sacred mystery. By the effectual working of your providence, carry out in tranquility the plan of salvation. Let the whole world see and know that things which were cast down are being raised up, and things which had grown old are being made new, and that all things are being brought to their perfection by him through whom all things were made, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen. Amen.
A reading from Malachi. See, I am sending my messenger to prepare a way before me, and the Lord whom you seek will suddenly come to his temple. The messenger of the covenant whom you seek will suddenly come to this temple. The messenger of the covenant in whom you delight, indeed he is coming, says the Lord of hosts. Who can endure the day of his coming, and who can stand when he appears? For he is like a refiner's fire and like the fuller's soap. He will sit as a refiner and purifier of silver, and he will purify the descendants of Levi and refine them like gold and silver, until they present the offerings to the Lord in righteousness. Then the offering of Judah and Jerusalem will be pleasing to the Lord, and is in the days of old as in former years. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Hermanos, todos los hijos de una familia tienen la misma sangre. Por eso, Jesús quiso ser de nuestra misma sangre para destruir con su muerte al diablo, que mediante la muerte dominaba a los hombres y para liberar a aquellos que, por temor a la muerte, vivían como esclavos toda su vida. Pues como bien saben, Jesús no vino a ayudar a los ángeles, sino a los descendientes de Abraham. Por eso tuvo que hacerse semejante a sus hermanos en todo, a fin de llegar a ser sumo sacerdote, misericordioso con ellos y fiel en las relaciones que median entre Dios y los hombres, y expiar así los pecados del pueblo. Como él mismo fue probado por medio del sufrimiento, puede ahora ayudar a los que están sometidos a la prueba. Palabra de Dios, the word of the Lord.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
When the time came for the purification, according to the law of Moses, Jesus' parents brought him up to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord as it is written in the law of the Lord. Every firstborn male shall be designated as holy to the Lord. And they offered a sacrifice according to what is stated in the law of the Lord, a pair of turtle doves or two young pigeons. Now there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon. This man was righteous and devout, looking forward to the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Spirit rested on him. It had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not see death before he had seen the Lord's Messiah. Guided by the Spirit, Simeon came into the temple, and when the parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him what was customary under the law, Simeon took him in his arms and praised God, saying, "Master, now you are dismissing your servant in peace according to your word. For my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the presence of all peoples, a light for revelation to the Gentiles and for the glory to your people Israel." And the child's father and mother were amazed at what was being said about him. Then Simeon blessed them and said to his mother Mary, "This child is destined for the falling and the rising of many in Israel, and to be a sign that will be opposed, so that the inner thoughts of many will be revealed, and a sword will pierce your own soul too." There was also a prophet, Anna, the daughter of Phanuel of the tribe of Asher. She was of a great age, having lived with her husband 7 years after her marriage, then as a widow to the age of 84. She never left the temple, but worshiped there with fasting and prayer night and day. At that moment, she came and began to praise God and to speak about the child to all who were looking for the redemption of Jerusalem. When they had finished everything required by the Lord, they returned to Galilee, to their own town of Nazareth. The child grew and became strong, filled with wisdom, and the favor of God was upon him. The Gospel of the Lord.
These eyes of mine have seen the Savior, whom you have prepared for all the world to see. In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Before I officially plunge into the sermon, a couple of personal words. I have known Bishop-elect Susan and her family for almost 20 years. For 11 of those years, she served under my supervision, working in two parishes. And then 3.5 years ago, when I retired, I became her curate at St. Paul's Church in Mishawaka, Indiana. So that means that Susan has served under my authority, and I have served under her authority. All of which is to say that I have a pretty good idea of the person you have elected to be the 11th Bishop of Southern Virginia. And I can say from personal experience that I believe that the Holy Spirit has chosen and formed her for this moment in her life and in yours. By happy accident of calendar, the ordination and consecration of a bishop is coinciding with the feast of the presentation of Christ in the temple. We'll linger for just a moment on the scene. Mary and Joseph bring the infant Jesus into the temple to present him to the Lord. Being poor, they can't afford a large animal, so they buy a couple of birds. In the crowd are two very old people, Simeon and Anna. They have been waiting for decades for the coming of the Messiah. Mary and Joseph walk in with the baby, and Simeon and Anna have an aha moment. He has come. Now, since only Simeon's words are recorded, I'm going to focus on them, but I dare say that Simeon's words could easily have been uttered by Anna herself. And Simeon's words, first to the Lord and then to Mary, form a set of priorities which I believe are particularly apt for Bishop-elect Susan and particularly apt for the Diocese of Southern Virginia. So, here's what Simeon says. Priority number one, look at Jesus. Mine eyes have seen thy salvation, or the more modern translation in Rite 2, these eyes of mine have seen the Savior. So there's your first priority, Susan. Look at Jesus. Or as the old gospel song says, turn your eyes upon Jesus, look full in his wonderful face. Now, the episcopate is a dangerous calling, and here I mean spiritually dangerous. They will dress you up in gorgeous vestments. Solomon, in all his glory, was not arrayed like one of these. People will treat you with deference, or at least most of the time. Now and then, people will kiss your ring. When you walk into a room, you become the center of attention. On one level, of course, this makes sense. The bishop, after all, is the symbol of unity for the church. The bishop binds the diocese to the wider church. And the bishop also binds the diocese to the church throughout history, going back to the apostles themselves. The bishop guards the faith, doctrine, and discipline and unity of the church. All of this is true. The danger is, it seems on the surface, that it's all about the bishop. But it's not all about the bishop. It's all about Jesus. I suspect many of the clergy here will identify with what I'm about to say. Clergy often have terrifying dreams of inadequacy. This is more information than you need about me, but my own dream, which crops up every 6 months or so, has me getting into the pulpit and realizing I've not prepared a sermon. I look out at the congregation, and I have nothing to say. Now, for some people, that's a fantasy, but in any event, we all have these dreams, and every profession has some sort of equivalent. There'd be lawyer inadequacy dreams and doctor inadequacy dreams and student inadequacy dreams. Bishops have their own special dreams, mostly about vestment malfunctions. One of mine actually came true when I put my mitre on backwards and the lappets were sticking down over my face. And I wondered why I couldn't see the congregation. But we need to remember, even when we do something ridiculous, even when we mess up royally, even when we fail, it's all about Jesus. The ordination and consecration of a bishop is a grand occasion. The church at its most joyful. We are setting apart a leader for a community of communities. And that's a wonderful thing. We're asking the Holy Spirit to put a mark on Susan's soul and to empower her for this ministry. But all the while, we need to remember, Bishop-elect Susan, you need a Savior. Presiding Bishop Michael and my colleagues, you and I need a Savior. All of you in the Diocese of Southern Virginia, you need a Savior. And the good news is that the Episcopate will drive you over and over into the arms of Jesus. Your prayer life, my sister, which is already rich and deep, will become richer and deeper, and you will discover in new ways your dependence upon Jesus. So Simeon says, look at Jesus. Second priority, speak about Jesus. These eyes of mine have seen the Savior whom you have prepared for all the world to see, a light to enlighten the nations and the glory of your people Israel. Some translations say a light to enlighten the Gentiles. When the nations, the Gentiles, and Israel are paired up, that's biblical shorthand for meaning everybody. This is for the whole world. Jesus is for absolutely everyone. And your second priority, my sister, is to talk about Jesus in season and out of season, to talk about Jesus when it's convenient and when it isn't, to talk about Jesus when people are receptive and when they aren't. In a few minutes, Bishop Michael will tell you the following. He will tell you that you are called to be one with the apostles in proclaiming Christ's resurrection and interpreting the gospel, and to testify to Christ's sovereignty as Lord of Lords and King of Kings. These aren't mere words. They are a solemn undertaking. Bishops have nothing special or original to say. I know that may be shocking to my Episcopal colleagues, but it's absolutely true. Our ministry is to take what has been placed lovingly in our hands and to pass it on as faithfully and as accurately as we can. A bishop's message should never be, how shall I put it, idiosyncratic. Oh, yes. A bishop should be winsome, should be creative. We should apply the gospel to the realities of life today. My sister, don't be afraid of the hard edges of the gospel and the way that the gospel challenges the world and its false gods. But the center of the message, whether you're addressing a parish or the diocese or the world beyond, the center of the message is Jesus. You have no message but Jesus Christ and Him crucified, Jesus Christ and Him risen. And I speak from personal experience, and my colleagues will bear me out, it's enormously difficult to keep that focus, isn't it? Because there's so much that impinges on our lives, the administrative concerns which can bear us down, dealing with parish conflict, mentoring ordinands and clergy, not to mention responsibilities beyond the diocese. My sister, your calendar will be fuller than it has ever been in your life, and you will say to yourself over and over, my calendar is out of control. And yet, keep your focus on Jesus and proclaim Him day in and day out. That's a challenge which requires the power of the Holy Spirit, which is why we're going to lay our hands on you and ask God to fill you from head to toe and overflowing with His Spirit. The third priority, carry the cross. and a sword will pierce your own soul also. Frankly, I wish this had come first, not last, but I'm taking the text in its order. Simeon turns his attention from speaking to the Lord to speaking to Mary. Mary, the God-bearer, about her own vocation. Now, yes, she's had the privilege of holding the infant Jesus, the Word made flesh. And she will see Jesus grow and mature. Someday she will live to see him perform miracles and proclaim the kingdom of God. But someday, too, she will stand at the foot of the cross and watch him die. Someday, too, at least according to Christian art, she will hold in her arms, the same arms which cradled the infant Jesus, she will hold in her arms the dead body of her son. In other words, part of Mary's vocation, and all of our vocations, and in a particular way for the bishop, is to carry the cross. I once heard a sermon by a Presbyterian minister named Elam Davies. He was the pastor decades ago of a Fourth Presbyterian Church in Chicago, a Welshman. I don't remember much about this sermon. It was on Good Friday, but I remember one sentence which has seared itself into my heart. And the sentence is this: if you want to know what God is like, you must see him in his powerlessness. Mary saw God in his powerlessness as an infant and as the crucified Lord. Jesus invites you, my sister, to gaze at the powerless one and to share his cross. It's the privilege and the burden of every bishop to experience both the joy and the pain of the church. My sister, you will see the church at its very best. You will witness heroic ministries to the poorest of the poor. You will meet Christians who put their lives, literally their lives, on the line for Jesus. You will hear stories of conversion. You will see communities of Christians, large ones, but in wondrous ways, small ones, that do extraordinary ministry for Jesus. All of that is true. You'll see the church at its best. You will also see the church at its worst. You will see Christians when they devour one another. You will experience conflict that, despite the best will of everyone involved, simply doesn't get itself resolved. You will minister to churches, small churches that wonder, will we be here in 6 months or a year? You will hear of joys and hopes, but you will also hear of fears and anxieties. And there's that phrase of St. Paul in 2 Corinthians, and beside other things, I am under daily pressure because of my anxiety for the churches. And that too, my sister, is part of your vocation. For years as a diocesan bishop, I had a kind of fantasy that I'd get a call someday that would go like this: Bishop, I just called to tell you how much I love my diocese and how much I love my parish and how much I love my church. That's all I want to tell you, Bishop. I am so happy, and that's why I called. I waited 16 years for that call. But sad to say, when bishops pick up the phone, they don't generally hear that. That's the deal. And Jesus invites us to carry the cross. Now, as I said, I wish this had come first, not last, but I am going to end by reminding you of something even more splendid. That as you carry the cross, you will experience grace beyond your imagining. Mary experienced the cross, and she saw her risen Son. And you and I can encounter the risen Lord as well, who raises us up when we bear his cross. Every one of my Episcopal colleagues can affirm with me that this is a ministry of grace beyond measure. I would not trade a single day of this ministry, and neither, my dear sister, will you. And Jesus is giving you gifts as you say yes to his call. He's giving you companions on this journey, colleague bishops, clergy and laity of this wonderful diocese, friends who will raise you up and strengthen you. He's placed you in a succession of bishops who have known and loved and fearlessly preached the Lord Jesus. And he will empower you with the Holy Spirit in dramatic, but more often in undramatic ways to do what you cannot imagine. And so Simeon's words to Bishop-elect Susan are words to all of us as well. Look at Jesus. Speak about Jesus. Carry the cross. These eyes of mine have seen the Savior, whom you have prepared for all the world to see. Amen.
My sister, the people have chosen you and have affirmed their trust in you by acclaiming your election. A bishop in God's holy church is called to be one with the apostles in proclaiming Christ's resurrection and interpreting the gospel and to testify to Christ's sovereignty as Lord of Lords and King of Kings. You are called to guard the faith, unity, and discipline of the Church, to celebrate and to provide for the administration of the sacraments of the New Covenant, to ordain priests and deacons, and to join in ordaining bishops, and to be in all things a faithful pastor and wholesome example for the entire flock of Christ. With your fellow bishops, you will share in the leadership of the Church throughout the world. Your heritage is the faith of patriarchs, prophets, apostles, and martyrs, and those of every generation who have looked to God in hope. Your joy will be to follow him who came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life a ransom for many. My sister, are you persuaded that God has called you to the office of bishop?
I am so persuaded.
My sister, will you accept this call and fulfill this trust in obedience to Christ?
I will obey Christ and serve in his name.
Will you be faithful in prayer and in the study of Holy Scripture that you may have the mind of Christ?
I will, for he is my help.
Will you boldly proclaim and interpret the gospel of Christ, enlightening the minds and stirring up the conscience of your people?
I will, in the power of the Spirit.
As a chief priest and pastor, will you encourage and support all baptized people in their gifts and ministries, nourish them from the riches of God's grace, pray for them without ceasing, and celebrate with them the sacraments of our redemption?
I will, in the name of Christ, the shepherd and bishop of our souls.
Will you guard the faith, unity, and discipline of the Church?
I will, for the love of God.
Will you share with your fellow bishops in the government of the whole Church? Will you sustain your fellow presbyters and take counsel with them? Will you guide and strengthen the deacons and all others who minister in the Church?
I will, by the grace given me.
Will you be merciful to all, show compassion to the poor and strangers, and defend those who have no helper?
I will, for the sake of Christ Jesus.
Susan, through these promises, you have committed yourself to God to serve his Church in the office of bishop. We therefore call upon you, chosen to be a guardian of the Church's faith, to lead us in confessing that faith.
We believe in one God.
We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins.
We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Come, Holy Ghost, our souls inspire, enlightened with celestial fire. Thou the anointing Spirit art, who dost thyself forgives impart. Thy blessed unction from above is comfort, life, and fire of love. Enable with perpetual light the dullness of our blinded sight. Anoint and cheer our soiled face with the abundance of thy grace. Keep far our foes, give peace at home. Where thou art guide, no ill can come. Teach us to know the Father, Son, and thee above to be but one, that through the ages all along this may be our endless song. Praise to thy eternal merit, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, Father of mercies and God of all comfort, dwelling on high but having regard for the lowly, knowing all things before they come to pass, we give you thanks that from the beginning you have gathered and prepared a people to be heirs of the covenant of Abraham and have raised up prophets, kings, and priests, never leaving your temple untended. Praise you also that from the creation you have graciously accepted the ministry of those whom you have chosen. Therefore, Father, make Susan a bishop in your church, pour out upon her the power of your princely spirit, whom you bestowed upon your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, with whom he endowed the apostles, and by whom your church is built up in every place to the glory and unceasing praise of your name. To you, O Father, all hearts are open. Fill, we pray, the heart of this your servant, whom you have chosen to be a bishop in your church, with such love of you and of all the people, that she may feed and tend the flock of Christ and exercise without reproach the high priesthood to which you have called her, serving before you day and night in the ministry of reconciliation, declaring pardon in your name, offering the holy gifts, and wisely overseeing the life and work of the church. In all things, may she present before you the acceptable offering of a pure and gentle and holy life. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be honor and power and glory in the church, now and forever.
Amen.
Susan, on behalf of the clergy and people of the Diocese of Southern Virginia, I give into your hands this pastoral staff. May Christ the Good Shepherd uphold you and sustain you as you carry it in his name.
Amen. My sister, receive the Holy Scriptures. Feed the flock of Christ committed to your charge. Guard and defend them in his truth, and be a faithful steward of God's holy word and sacraments. Brothers, sisters, siblings, greet your new bishop.
Thank you.
peace.
My beloved family in Christ, may the peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you. Yay, God. Yay, God. Peace be with you, Jay.
Good job, brother. Good job. There we go.
Peace, Doug. Peace be with you. Thank you.
Peace of the Lord be with you, Susan.
And also with you, Jay. Peace, Susan. Peace, Frank. Thank you. Peace, Ed. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Yeah. Peace be with you.
Back on later.
Yeah. God's peace. Oh, okay. So I should step out of the way. Oh, all right. Peace be with you. Thank you. Peace be with you, Tom. Yeah. Peace be with you, Barbara.
Peace be with you.
You said the book is marked, right?
It's marked.
And can you remind me what preface I'm singing?
Apostles and Ordination.
Thank you. Yeah, well, that makes sense. Okay. Yeah. Is that a seat for you? You know what? Can I give you this? Some announcements, but I don't know if I'm the one that starts. Do I do announcements? Where's
announcements? You should welcome everybody.
I should start right now. Good morning, good afternoon, my brothers and sisters, and my beloved family in Christ. I wish to express my profound gratitude that all of you have come to join us in this celebration. It is such a joy to see you. I am especially grateful for the music ministry of the choir and all the musicians. A special thanks to the liturgy committee and the transition committee for all of their hard work over many, many months with sometimes some bumps in the road and, we would get thrown off kilter, but always land on our feet, and so I appreciate their flexibility. My gratitude to the co-consecrating bishops and to the bishops who are visiting, all the clergy of the diocese. Special thanksgiving to my family who have come from all parts of the country to be with me. I would like to recognize Pastor Travis. Where is he? We could not have done this without Williamsburg Community Chapel's generous and humble hospitality. And so we are grateful to the clergy and staff of this remarkable place. Before I hand things back over to the presiding bishop, I just want to remind us all as followers of Christ that, as you know, I mean, this is not news to you, the church is changing. And the church that we recognize and promote right now is not going to be the church we have in 20 years. And I want us to keep our eyes open and our hearts in tune with how that church is changing, so that in 20 years we'll recognize it when it gets here. So we have work to do. Put your running shoes on, and let's get going. And now it's my pleasure to hand this back over to Presiding Bishop Michael Curry. Yes, there you are.
Thank you. Don't go anywhere. Come on back. Come on back. You're the bishop. We're just guests now.
Oh. Okay.
Well, on behalf of your brothers, sisters, siblings who are the Episcopal Church, wherever they are, and they're all over the globe, wherever they are, I bring you their greetings, assure you of their prayers, and their Episcopalians all over the world shouting glory, hallelujah, even as we speak. In a few moments, you'll have an opportunity to give an offering for the new bishop's discretionary fund. And I have to tell you, the discretionary fund of every bishop is used for purposes that usually aren't included in the budget and very often are for pastoral needs and necessities, things that come up in the lives of people where there's no other source of funding. So I really do invite you to be as generous as you can to get Bishop Susan's fund off to a great run. And as many of you know, George Washington was an Episcopalian, and I trust a very devout one, and he's on the dollar bill. that there are some other lesser well-known people from our history, a Benjamin, an Alexander, of far greater denominational value. They should be invited to church also.
Thank you.
Okay. Okay.
Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God.
You're gonna get her. Thank you.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give great thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, through the great shepherd of your flock, Jesus Christ our Lord, who after his resurrection sent forth his apostles to preach the gospel and to teach all nations, and promised to be with them always, even to the end of the ages. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn, to proclaim the glory of your name.
Thanks to you, O God, for the goodness and love which you have made known to us in creation, in the calling of Israel to be your people, in your word spoken through the prophets, and above all in the word made flesh, Jesus, your Son. For in these last days you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary, to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him you have delivered us from evil and made us worthy to stand before you. In him you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. On the night before he died for us, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, according to his command, O Father, we remember his death, we proclaim his resurrection, we await his coming in glory. And we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, O Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we may be acceptable through him being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ, and bring us to that heavenly country where with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Blessed Joseph, Anna, and Simeon, and all your saints, we may enter the everlasting heritage of your sons and daughters. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation.
By him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
As our Savior Christ has now taught us, we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Thank you. Christ.
The gifts of God for the people of God. And then I go down there, right? Okay. Nope.
Let us pray. Almighty Father, we thank you for feeding us the holy food and the body and blood of your Son, for you for uniting us through him in the fellowship of your Holy Spirit. We thank you for raising up among us faithful servants in the ministry of your word and sacraments. We pray that Susan may be a blessed, effective example, word and action, in love and patience, and in holiness of life. Grant that we, with her, may serve you now, and always rejoice in your glory. Through Jesus Christ, our Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Our help is in the name of the Lord.
The maker of heaven and earth.
Blessed be the name of the Lord.
From this time forth forevermore.
The blessing, mercy, and grace of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you forever.
Amen.